Americans want to eat healthier. They just don't quite know where to start. I'll show you how small changes can have a major impact on your health. For most Americans, moving toward a healthier lifestyle is as simple as this. Eat less, move more. Include more fruits, vegetables, whole grains, and legumes, and eat fewer processed foods high in harmful fats, sugars, and sodium. Hi, I'm Laura Davidson, registered dietitian and assistant professor of nutrition here at Community College of Philadelphia. Today on Good Nutrition Made Easy, we're going to look at portion distortion. Could supersized portions be leading to supersized people and supersized healthcare costs? Going to take a look at the history behind portion distortion and then actually have some demonstrations to show you what an adequate portion looks like compared to a supersized portion. So let's look at the history of portion distortion. Over the past 20 years or so, portions that are served by restaurants have doubled and even tripled in size. This trend began in the 1970s, accelerated in the 1980s, and is still happening today. Portions are just getting larger and larger. This is a selling point for the food industry. The next time you're in a fast food restaurant, a chain restaurant, or any food establishment, take a look around. They're convincing you through posters and placemats that these larger portions are in fact a great bargain. In fact, pizzerias are using larger pizza pans, fast food restaurants are using larger cups and French fry containers, and restaurants in general are using larger plates. And they've done their job well. Most Americans, when looking for food, look for big portions. They consider that getting a lot for their money, a good bargain. But are these large portion sizes a health bargain? Let's take a look at this chart to compare how portions have increased and the calorie cost of those increases. You can see that the government standard is listed, which is much smaller than what we're being served. In many cases, the increase in portion has cost us hundreds and in some cases close to 1,000 calories. The 40 to 60 ounce fountain drink, for instance, is well over 500 calories. Keep in mind a few things. First of all, the average American should be consuming around 2,000 calories per day. So a 500 calorie soft drink provides a quarter of your calorie needs for the day from a beverage that has little nutrient value. Look at the steak, again, a doubling in most cases in the calorie costs. Now, how does this relate to overweight and obesity? In past episodes of this program, we've talked about what's called energy balance. All these extra calories, when not balanced by an increase in energy expenditure, leads to body fat gain. So it could be, and most expert thinks is, a major contributor to our current issue with body weight in this country. I'm going to briefly cover some really neat research that's come out about why Americans eat what they do. I'm going to focus on two researchers. Dr. Brian Wansink works out of Cornell University's Food and Brand Lab. Dr. Wansink has done some really interesting and sometimes funny studies that look at why we eat what we do. His summary after he completes study after study is that Americans eat primarily because of accessibility and convenience. What this means is we eat it because it's there. And we stop when it's finished. And I'll fill you in on some of his research shortly. Dr. Wansink says that we're a nation of mindless eaters. We're eating with our eyes and certainly not listening to our stomachs and the cues that tell us when we should be feeling full. In one experiment, Dr. Wansink brought people in for a soup luncheon. half of the study subjects had a refillable soup bowl that they didn't know about. There was a feeder tube which fed the bottom of the soup bowl and kept the level constant. Those participants with the refillable bowls drank 70% more soup than those without. And when they rated their feeling of fullness at the end, they didn't rate themselves as being any more full than those with the regular soup bowl. What this shows is we eat with our eyes. Because their soup bowl was not emptying, they thought they still needed to keep eating. Dr. Wansink has noticed that people eat 73% more from a candy bowl on the desk compared to candy in the drawer. We see it. We eat it. While watching TV and mindlessly eating, we consume 30% more than if the TV was off. And interestingly, Dr. Wansink has even noticed that we pour more beverages into short, chunkier glasses than tall, thin glasses. And he says this is due to our natural tendency to misjudge the effect of height proportionate to width, which is very interesting. Now, what does Dr. Wansink say that we should use as strategies? Change the environment. If we eat because of accessibility, convenience, visibility, then cancel out those things. Instead of putting candy in a bowl on your table, put fruit in that bowl on the table. Instead of using chunky glasses, use tall, thin glasses, smaller plates. And we'll look at more of those strategies later on in the program. David Kessler is a physician, lawyer, and former commissioner of the Food and Drug Administration in the United States. He's looked at why we crave the type of foods that the food industry is manufacturing. He says that the food industry knows what types of foods make us overeat. Sugar, fat, and salt, Dr. Kessler says, are hijacking the brains of millions of people by activating their neural circuits. What he's found is this layering of fat and sugar and salt causes a dopamine spike when we eat those foods. That feels good, that makes us crave those foods and head back for more. And the food industry realizes this, they've studied this, and they then create more and more foods that are loaded with fat and sugar and salt. Think about French fries smothered in cheese and bacon, or ice cream loaded with bits of candy. These are the types of foods that we crave after we've tried them. Now, what Dr. Kessler says that we should use as a strategy is to break that habit. He calls it food rehab. And he says that we should try to stay away from that type of food and reintroduce more natural foods, the fresh fruits and the vegetables and the legumes. Limit the processed stuff. Now we're going to do some food demonstrations, looking at these portion sizes and offering some tips for how to reacquaint yourselves with what an appropriate portion would be for most people. Stay with us. Next, we'll have our local expert and a conversation on behavior modification for weight management. I'd like to welcome our local expert today, Dr. Donald Bowers. Dr. Bowers is our Director of Psychology here at the Community College of Philadelphia. Welcome.
Well, thank you, Laura. I'm glad to be here.
It's nice to have you. Let's talk a little bit about behavior modification and its use in managing body weight.
Okay.
I've heard a little bit of the terms cues, internal cues and external cues. Can you describe what they are and how we use them?
Yes, they're very relevant when you start talking about hunger, because most people, when they think of hunger, they think the feelings of hunger just come from your stomach or low blood sugar. But they really don't. They also come from what we call external cues, like when we see food, it makes us feel hungry, or when we smell it, it makes us feel hungry. And in particular, people can be external cues, like when you see other people eating, or when you eat with other people, or you talk to other people about food. Those are all external cues that can trigger your desire to eat.
Okay. Is there a way to manage those cues then, or perhaps interpret them differently so that someone who struggles with overeating has a better hold on things?
Well, I think there is. I mean, probably the first thing is simply to become aware that external cues will trigger your desire to eat more. One thing would be to stay away from those cues that you know are going to elicit the desire to eat. So for instance, if there's a bakery, you probably should stay away from in front of it. When you have food and you don't want to be hungry, you don't want food in your sight. You don't want it sitting on the table. You don't want it easily accessible, because the more you see it, the easier it is to get at, the more likely you are to eat it.
That's good advice. We're entering a season, and the holiday season and the post-holiday season. In fact, this episode will be aired the first time during that season. It mm-hmm. is a time filled with external cues.
Yes.
It seems everywhere you look, there is food in your face, as you would say.
Yes.
What could you suggest to our viewers to get through the holiday season, perhaps, with managing their weight still as something that they can do?
Well, this holiday season, as you were mentioning, is a tremendous challenge for anybody who's trying to diet or to lose weight. I think one thing you could think of is, one would be portion size. So for instance, when you take food, let's say at the dinner table, you take small sizes. And the reason for that is many of us, unfortunately, have been taught to clean our plate.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not eating everything on the plate because we're hungry. We're eating it because it's there. We see it and we want to eat it. There are other behaviorist techniques that you could use, but they're hard at this time of the year. You put food out of sight. You try to say that you'll only eat at certain times of the day. So you say, well, I'll eat at noon, I'll eat at 6. But at other times, you don't eat. And probably one other piece of advice I could give you is that we tend to do things like watch television and eat snacks.
Mm-hmm.
We talk to people and eat snacks at the same time. We do that non-consciously, and we don't realize how much we really eat.
Mm-hmm.
That's an important thing to avoid.
Okay, that mindless eating.
The mindless eating,
yeah.
Absolutely.
And I've heard some people even make rules. I will not eat in front of the television set for that reason, or I won't have the television on while I am eating dinner at the dinner table. So you're a little more focused and conscious about what you're eating.
I think that's an excellent idea. You can set up those rules ahead of time,
mm-hmm.
and then whenever you're in a situation, you can fall back and say, uh-oh, that's my rule. I don't eat and watch television. And it gives you better control.
Yeah, and one other thing, when you mentioned awareness,
mm-hmm.
they've actually done studies to show that keeping records doubles
mm-hmm.
your success with weight loss. Is that something that you would advise too, like a little journal or diary of some type?
Absolutely. You keep records and you're less likely to do it because you have to write it down.
Yeah.
Is that, because then you feel guilty when you write it down. It also allows you to track. And it's also what the behaviorists would talk of as a reinforcement. When you do well
mm-hmm.
and you stick to your diet, you say, I really accomplished it. I know it because I have no bad marks in my journal. And that really rewards you for your success.
Okay, thanks. Those were excellent tips. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.
Bowers.
I
Great to have you here today.
Okay, I enjoyed it.
Let's have a demonstration and some tips as well regarding portion distortion. So what I did was I went to some local restaurants and ordered up a single serving of food for dinner. Let's start with the Italian restaurant. Now this is what I received for a dinner-sized meal of spaghetti and meatballs. Again, for most Americans, that may not seem unusual, but let's look how it compares to standards. Now, I want to give you a little tip to start. I'm going to use, for the next few demonstrations, a smaller plate. This is actually very, very helpful. This is what is now called a luncheon plate, typically about 8 inches across. What you're seeing being used in restaurants and even in homes is much, much larger, 10 inches or more. This is more appropriate for a healthy portion, okay, for a portion that is good for the typical American. So let's start with a smaller plate, this 8-inch plate. Now we've got this spaghetti and meatballs. By the way, it feels as if it weighs a pound. Let's look at what is a recommended portion. And we're going to use some typical objects, common objects, as cues. The hope here is that when you next think about spaghetti, you'll think light bulb. Okay? The size of a portion of spaghetti should be about the size of a three-way light bulb. Now, right off the bat, we should be gasping because what we have here is something much, much bigger. But let's put it on our smaller plate and see how we do. So I'm going to use my little pasta server here. And let's get that portion about the size of a light bulb. Okay. Now, we'll talk about whether this would satisfy an appetite and how to make it satisfy an appetite later. Okay. So, about, okay? So what I have is the recommended portion of spaghetti, which barely made a dent in my dinner size serving. Now that's a light bulb size is about what a pasta meal should be. That's not a side that is a full meal. But we've got our meatballs. The common portion indicator for a serving of meat is the deck of cards, which makes it a little difficult for our meatballs because they are shaped nothing like a deck of cards. But let's give it a shot here. Okay. Messing up the table here. Maybe a meatball and a half would be about 3 ounces. A deck of size portion of meat is about 3 ounces. Okay, so there we go. Hold this up and maybe hold up our original. This is what a portion should look like. This is what we're being served. And that should make us all think, wow, we're really off base with regards to what the food industry is serving us. This spaghetti dinner could actually probably feed an entire family if you were eating the correct portions. Now you might ask, but that looks like a measly little portion there. Remember, we don't have the most important part of this meal, which contrary to American thinking is not the meat or the pasta, it's the vegetables and the fruit. Make a pretty green salad to fill up most of this plate or serve on the side, and that would add a lot to the satiety value, the feeling of fullness, the appeal of this meal, actually. So add a salad. Add a glass of water or a glass of low-fat milk, and you've got your meal. Let's do a different meal here, and that would be stir-fried chicken and broccoli. And I've got my rice, and I want to give you another little tip here. I've got a plate that is this smaller plate. Most health agencies are saying, I'm writing on my plate. You don't have to write on your plate at home. That I've just divided into 2 quarters and a half. When we fill up our plate, half of our plate should be the fruit and the vegetable. A quarter should be the meat or protein. Okay, that last little quarter should be the starch, and hopefully that's a whole grain. The pasta wasn't a whole grain, and that would have been better if it was. So with this stir-fried chicken and broccoli, that's what I'm gonna use as my portion indicators. I'm gonna use my plate and the dividers there. So here's my rice. Okay, and if you like it better served on top, you could certainly do that later. All right, there's my rice. The meat. This looks pretty heavy on the meat, a lot more than that quarter of a plate there. Okay. And again, most of what we're going to be eating, and I'll explain why in just a minute, should be the fruit and the vegetables. Fruits and vegetables are lower in calories and richer in nutrients, including fiber. And fiber is actually very, very helpful for managing weight because it gives you a feeling of fullness. It has a lot of other benefits as well. Now, you're going to notice that what we're being served is very different in proportion to what agencies like the American Heart Association and the American Institute of Cancer Research think we should be eating. Tried my best here for you. But what you can see is mostly broccoli, a bit of chicken, a bit of rice would be an appropriate serving for most Americans. Now, let me show you kind of the proportions of the meal. We like meat in this country, so that's what we're being served. I have almost all chicken left, very little broccoli. So this type of proportion would be easier to do if you were doing it yourself. I do want to mention one thing before I move on, and that is there's a psychological adjustment that needs to take place when you scale down your portions. It's certainly a benefit health-wise. There's no two ways about it, but it is a big step, and you need to get used to these smaller portions. Something, the smaller plates help for sure. Another really important tip is to slow down when you're eating. You know, Americans are used to gobbling their food. We're very, very busy. We don't have much time to eat. Eat consciously, enjoy the flavors in the food, but slow down so you're more satisfied with these smaller servings. The other thing to keep in mind is to fill in with foods that have very few calories but a lot of nutrients. So something I mentioned, the salad, I mentioned a glass of water, a glass of low-fat milk. So you certainly don't need to feel deprived necessarily when you do go this direction. Okay, one more food, very popular one, and that is the bagel. Okay, and what I have here is a bagel from a very popular donut and bagel shop. And the size is about the size of my hand. It's quite large, but it looks very typical because that's what we've been served for a while. The standard for a bagel, as far as health and appropriate portion size, is about the size of a hockey puck. So you can see here that, you know, as far as the bread, that we might have a doubling of bagel size here. Something else, I don't know if you remember the chart, but the standard bagel portion set by the government is about 2 ounces. And what we have here, this is a very inexpensive little scale, about 6 ounces. Okay, this isn't a bagel. This is 2 bagels, and actually it is 2 bagels each worth 2 ounces of grain. Let me explain that because that's a little bit confusing. We're saying that the average bagel from that donut shop is 2 bagels, okay? When we look at recommended servings portions for Americans, most Americans need about 6 ounces of grain per day. Now again, back to the scale. This entire bagel, 6 ounces. So what that tells you, in one fell swoop, you just consumed all of the grain that you need in that morning bagel. We don't think that way, but that's the way health works. Now I want to show you some other cues that might be helpful to keep in mind as you go through your day. Often a tennis ball is used for a half a cup, something like a dish of pudding or sherbet or low-fat ice cream. A tennis ball serving would be a good serving for you. They use the 9-volt battery to indicate 1.5 ounces of cheese. So if you're having a snack of a low-fat cheese with some whole grain crackers, that size, you know, it's a lot different than cutting it off the brick of cheese. And as I'm talking about that, let me mention one of the things that Dr. Wansink recommended was to prepare portions of your snacks and your meals. Don't eat family style. Don't eat out of the bag. And let me talk about that for a minute. I have a bag of pretzels. The tendency when eating from an entire bag of snacks is to not feel as if you've made much of a dent because of the size of that bag. So it's kind of, again, eating with your eyes instead of your stomach. One bit of advice is to pack things up or to measure them out. These little snack baggies work really well for snacks. They limit how much, and they probably give you about 100 calorie portion size. Another cue for snacks, like potato chips, which you shouldn't eat too much, but potato chips and pretzels, is a teacup size. So let's look at that. A teacup size of a snack is about 120 calories. So if you don't want to buy the 100 calorie packs, you can think teacup. Now, I'm not talking about those oversized coffee mugs, because that would give you a lot more. But a teacup serving of pretzels is somewhere around 120 calories worth of pretzels. Let's see what else we have here. I love cashews. I do love nuts. But the one thing you have to remember with nuts, although they're very healthy, they have a lot of healthy oils. They're very high in fiber, give you some protein. They're also very high in fat and calories as well. Using the golf ball portion size is helpful for things like dried fruit and nuts, healthy foods that are, however, very high in calories. I also say the palm of the hand, the little cup that your hand would make. So again, if you want a serving of nuts, go ahead. But portion out a golf ball portion size, put it in, you know, a little plate or some type of a container, close up the can, put it away, that whole convenience of visibility, and enjoy. Let's see what else I've got here. This, the old floppy disk, is about the size of a portion of bread. So again, even some loaves of bread are gigantic, so that helps. And this, baseball size, is about a cup. So those might be helpful for you. So hopefully you have some good strategies to help you battle portion distortion. Thanks for joining us on Good Nutrition Made Easy. For more information, contact the college. And remember, eat well, but eat less. You'll be healthier for it.